keep on running because the winner don't quit on themselves. What's up, Wisconsin? I'm Maggie Dawn. This is the Civic Media Radio Network. Want to just jump right in today, let y'all know we're going to be breaking some news in the next hour. You are not going to want to miss it. Absolutely critical news. Really excited to be welcoming a guest that has, again, major news when it comes to the Wisconsin political landscape. Don't go anywhere. But I wanted to start today. There's a Substack that I read, which is basically folks giving commentary on different and observations on different news items and things. But I have a favorite. It's written by a guy by the name of Brian Butler. And he put out a piece this week talking about basically the mood of the country about the economy. And I thought this is important because in reality, we, the United States, are basically doing the best of any westernized democracy in terms of our economic recovery following the 2020 downturn. And despite this, I think a lot of people, and rightly so, are experiencing, still feel like they're experiencing pain. But the manner in which the press covers the economy is just as important. And so I wanted to start this portion of the show this afternoon by asking you all, where do you get your economic news? Are you seeking it out? Do you trust what you hear? What sources do you trust? So where do you get your news about the economy? 855-75-CIVIC, 855-752-4842. And don't worry, I never leave you hanging. I'm going to have some suggestions for reliable economic news sources before the half an hour or 45 minutes is out. That's absolutely essential, and I will get you that. But I want to hear from you first. Where do you get your economic news? 855-75-CIVIC. That's 855-752-4842. You can call or text us. Remember, of course, you can always go get the Civic Media app and then just with one click, call or text us. But basically, since the beginning of the year, the mainstream news media has gone from a lot of hand-wringing and, oh, the economy is not good. The mainstream media has kind of come around to begrudgingly accept and talk about the fact that the U.S. economic recovery is robust and strong and continuing. And one need only look at just headlines this week from what are not liberal newspapers or liberal outlets. The Financial Times had a headline 2 days ago on the 16th that read this, U.S. to grow at double the rate of G7 peers this year, according to the International Monetary Fund. Financial Times, not a liberal newspaper by any stretch. Wall Street Journal, also not a liberal paper, had this to say on April 14th. Envy of the world, U.S. economy expected to keep powering higher. Economists lift their growth forecasts in latest Wall Street Journal survey. So I want to know, are y'all reading the Financial Times? Are you reading the Wall Street Journal? Where else are you getting your economic news from? Because, again, economics, not the easiest subject. I have a master's degree in mathematical economics. Many of you know that. And one thing that always bugged me about econ was that when explained well, it's understandable to regular folks. But like a lot of professions, lawyers included, I'm a double banger there, right? An economist and a lawyer. The practitioners tend to speak in lingo. And I think that's both part of the trade, but also makes them feel smart. Makes it seem like they have some very unique, specialized knowledge. You can only get it from these people. But economics is accessible. And if a good economist is explaining things, you should be able to understand it, period, full stop. If you don't dig deeper, ask questions if it is an open sort of Q&A format. Because I'll tell you why I became an economist, why I ended up with my undergrad in econ, going on to get my master's degree in a really hard applied math-based graduate program in economics. It's because in my freshman year, I took a microeconomics class. And my professor, a guy by the name of Bill Hunter, he was explaining complementary and substitute goods. Ooh, what are those? I might have an idea of what those are. And he said, don't worry, I'll always give you some examples. So Bill said the complementary goods, beer and pretzels. Aha, yes, I can understand that. Beer and pizza, complementary goods. Cheese and crackers, right? Okay, we got it. We all understand what complementary goods are now. Milk and cookies. Substitute goods, Bud Light, Miller Lite. Okay, I get it, right? So I use that as an illustration. I thought when he explained it that way, I thought this is interesting. And what engaged me more about economics is that it is based in data and it is measurable, but it also involves human behavior and human decision-making. So it's sort of like art data, art math, if you will. And I knew very early on that economics was part of the stock and trade of politics. That economics doesn't exist in a bubble of academics and data wonks, but that politicians use economics to make pro and con arguments for their policy proposals or to criticize their opponents. And what I came to understand as a young graduate student is that economic data is subject to spin, both in terms of the analysis itself and how even really good objective analysis is spun or talked about. Because it is a data-based analytical system, people get turned off. They don't, well, I don't want to read the source material. That's boring. And economists aren't always great like Dr. Hunter was at explaining things. And so as I learned more about it, it became very clear to me that learning how to spot bad economic analysis was going to be really important to me if I wanted to be the most knowledgeable voter I could. And maybe some of you have heard this term, that there's the movement of law and economics. That's also a thing. And so a lot of legal theories, starting in the mid-90s, started to incorporate economic theory. So for me, as I went through my education, I wanted to be able to understand so I could know when I was getting duped, when the data was bad or the analysis was biased or when they were manipulating the sorts of analysis that they would use to achieve a certain outcome so they could make a particular legal or political argument. And that's something that here on the show, I try to work with you all so that we all can become better consumers of information, better voters, especially economic information, because it is susceptible to manipulation. So it has been a fascination of mine that in sum, while our country has experienced unquestionably inflation at these levels and higher before, it didn't generate in recent memory this much economic despair. In other words, public perception hasn't been this sticky, especially a year after inflation has, for all intents and purposes, ended. The last time interest rates were at the level that they're at right now, public perception of the economy was high. It was good. So what is going on? And so Brian Buettler's Substack, he posits some theories. And I, again, my question to you all is, where do you get your economic news? Do you trust it? Can you verify it? How do you read it? 855-752-4842. Are there topics? Do you want me to address certain things? How can we learn better together? Because again, this public, the stickiness of public perception, inflation's been done for basically a year. Now I'll talk about a couple of the reasons why people may still feel like they're getting pinched. But one of my suggestions or theories or reasons that I'll share with you, and I want to hear your reactions too, of course, is that media coverage has been terrible. It's only now started to come around where the media is saying, and I mean print and radio and TV, where they're saying, yeah, U.S. economy, robust, improving, on the upswing, doing great. Again, that's from Financial Times. Growing at double the rate of our G7 peers, Wall Street Journal. We're the envy of the world. And yet, public perception remains unsteady, low. People don't think the economy is doing good, but that ain't reality. So why is there that disconnect? Tom from Grafton, where do you get your economic news? Do you trust it? What do you think's going on?
Well, I try and stay away from right wing. There's a lot of deception, I think. My brother has actually turned me on to a guy from the Clinton era, Robert Reich, and I was wondering what you had thought about him. And I have another question, too, when you're done with that.
Sure. Robert Reich, famous economist. I haven't read his stuff in a little while. If I'm remembering correctly, he's a little bit controversial. But listen, to me, and I'll turn it back over to you, Tom, one of the things that I will recommend to people, and will do so now because you asked me the question here, is don't just read one source, right? Like, if you find someone that you think explains well and is accessible to you, great, lean into that. But do a little poking around. When they posit or give you an analysis, check it out. Hang on, Tom. We'll come right back to you. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network. You want to join our conversation? Where do you get your economic news? 855-75-CIVIC, 855-752-4842. Tom, hang on. I'll come right back to you after these brief messages. Welcome back, Wisconsin. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show. We are talking about economic news and where do we get it from and how do we analyze if it's reliable. Our friend Tom from Grafton called in, asked me what I thought about Robert Reich. He has, I think, one of the most accessible ways of explaining economics. And he's also pretty damn funny. He's got a wonderful Substack. He's written a book called The System Who Rigged It, How to Fix It. I was thinking of a different economist, honestly, when Tom asked me about him last segment. And I said, there's a little bit of controversy. No, I was not thinking about Robert Reich. My point still stands. Find somebody that speaks in language that is approachable to you and then poke around and verify a bit what they're saying. But Robert Reich, I think probably one of the best cabinet secretaries. He was head of the Department of Labor, if I'm recalling correctly. Again, he's written a book, latest book, The System Who Rigged It and How to Fix It. He's the Chancellor's Professor of Public Policy at the University of California at Berkeley and Senior Fellow at the Blum Center. He's written 17 other books, Aftershock, The Work of Nations, really great. Great author. But Tom, we ran out of time and you wanted to make another comment or ask another question. Go ahead, sir.
Yes. As a layperson, where can I search or look to see current Wisconsin laws that's in a form that I, as just a regular person, could find and understand? Is there a website or what?
Yeah, laws about a particular topic or just in general?
a particular topic?
Yeah, I think so there's the Legislative Research Bureau that works for the Wisconsin legislature. I think when you poke around on the state government's website, often their explanatory memos are really helpful because they're written for legislators who don't have a lot of time and oftentimes don't want a ton of really techno-speaky detail. So that's a good place. I also, often what I will do is I will read a number of news sources about a particular topic. I will click on those hyperlinks, drill down, try to find the source materials, and then look for other articles referring to those source materials. It's sort of like, do you cook at home at all, Tom?
A little.
Okay. So when you go to look up a recipe, I usually read about four or five different recipes and then I go, oh, okay, I know how to make that. Same thing here. Drill down, get to the nuts and bolts of it, read the source material, go back to some of the news coverage. Again, journalists generally aren't lawyers. There are some exceptions. Again, I'm an infotainer, so that ain't me, but I am a lawyer. And Tom, heck, shoot me an email. Ask me about a topic. Happy to do an explainer. Again, the mainstream press has come around, but there still remain pockets that seemingly keep promoting this idea that the economy isn't doing well. That is just factually inaccurate. There were just a couple of facts that I wanted to point out and share with folks. First of all, home ownership is in fact lower than it was 40 years ago, correctly adjusted for various different economic changes over time. But home ownership is actually higher now than it was a decade ago. So versus 40 years ago, lower. Versus a decade ago, home ownership higher, particularly for younger people. So, you know, what's going on there? And that's not to say that there aren't middle-class folks that earn a good living that still can't afford to buy a home. That's happening. But that has been the case for a long time, including through periods when public perception of our economic performance was really high. In other words, when you look at a macroeconomic trend, I'm going to tag it back to the Nixon-Reagan time period. Yeah, we've seen income stratification, you know, much more of the country's wealth going to the very, very rich and less in the middle class. And so, yes, that's why the comparison as to 40 years ago is that home ownership is lower. But again, that has been the case for a long time. And yet at times, public perception of economic performance was very, very high. Lisa from Waukesha, where do you get your economic news?
Oh, I get it from a lot of different sources. And I apologize, I've come in late, so I don't know if what I have to say has already been covered.
Go for it anyways.
Okay. I actually work for a shelter. And we see lots and lots of evictions and people who are unable to afford their rent. So in terms of that aspect of the economy, the affordable housing is a huge challenge. And the other bit was inflation is real. I don't blame Biden for it like, you know, some folks do. But it's a reality. And
so I just two things there. Lisa brought up. Thanks so much for the call, Lisa. We got a lot of callers stacked up. Want to get to everybody. Couple things there. Affordable housing is a big problem right now. Yes. And the economy is doing really well. So we've got to zoom out. That's sort of my point here. When we look at those phenomena, like what's going on there? Why is housing seemingly out of reach for many people, especially folks that are living paycheck to paycheck? And what are we doing about that? That is a key question. I would offer that in a lot of places, we have not properly developed and continue to push the availability of housing, our housing stock, especially for people that are living paycheck to paycheck. In other words, especially coming out of COVID, a lot of the housing starts, even when inflation was going up and interest rates were higher, were for homes of $400,000 or more, because that's where developers were making a lot of money. They weren't focused on building affordable middle-class family units, right? There's a lot of sort of luxury 1-2-bedroom apartments and a lot of super expensive homes getting built. We need more of the sorts of tax incentives to make it lucrative for developers to build affordable housing. I think in Milwaukee County, we've seen a lot of that work. I showed up at a hearing in Whitefish Bay before I was done as corporation counsel because they wanted to nix an affordable housing project in Whitefish Bay. And I just said, come on now. and they eventually adopted that. But I think you land on an important topic. If you are on the line, stay there. I will get to you. We're going to take a couple of quick messages, including your bottom of the hour farm update. I'm Maggie Dawn. We're talking about the economy. It's doing well, but why do people not believe that? More after just a quick few messages here on the Civic Media Radio Network. If you want to join us, folks, 855-75-CIVIC. That's 855-752-4842. Where do you get your economic news from, and how do you make sure that it's telling you the truth? Welcome back, Wisconsin. I'm Maggie Dawn. You are listening statewide to the Civic Media Radio Network. We're talking this afternoon about the economy and why basically inflation's been over for a year. And I'm going to get to the question that was posed by our friend Lisa before our last break. Inflation's been over for a year. And yet, you know, you listen to certain press outlets, and when they return, and Anya, we're going to take some of this Fox sound next, presently here. When you listen to certain networks, positive economic reports will come out, and you would swear that somebody stole their ice cream cone. Not met with, you know, the jubilation and positivity that one would expect otherwise. Let's take a quick listen. This is just about a month ago on Fox News, Fox Business. Waiting, we're going to have the sound here.
All right, the numbers are in. All right, the numbers are imminent right now. We've got the Dow Jones Industrial Average down about 200 points going into this number, which is going to be crossing right now. Shar Kasani, you've got the number.
We came in at 275,000. Wow. We were only looking for 200,000. That is much hotter than expected. We saw this again. We saw this in January. We saw this in December. We're seeing it again.
As if she's disappointed. Do you have the very beginning of that clip where the gentleman's talking about inflation? If you can, let me know when you're ready, Anya. Yeah, so we hear this a lot. If you're on the line, stay there, please. I'm going to get to you. Brian Butler in his Substack posits what I think are a couple of theories about why public perception remains low when it comes to the economic strength of the United States, which, again, according to the Financial Times and the Wall Street Journal, basically we're kicking the rest of the world's butt. Again, let's listen to this. Is the same Fox clip, the guy leading in talking about inflation.
At bringing core inflation down to 2%.
All right, yeah, the numbers are imminent right now.
We've got
the
Dow Jones there it is, bringing core inflation down to 2%. That's basically the target. Now, it's varied a little bit since this coverage, but inflation's been over for a year. So before I get to the three or four theories about why this public perception gap or this public perception that doesn't match reality continues to exist, I wanted to address what's going on in pricing, okay? Because there's actual inflation. And then there's what's going on with certain baskets of consumer goods. And we've heard this talked about. And this is what Robert Reich and others, this won't be the first time you heard this, they talk about greedflation. In other words, actual costs of inputs for certain consumer goods are down, yet the corporations that produce and manufacture these goods don't bring their prices down after their input costs or their cost of goods sold has in fact gone down. That's the greedflation part. And the reason this occurs is that corporations in many industries tend to have monopoly power, or they have high consumer loyalty to particular brands. If you're looking at your favorite product and you're getting less of it, or the prices have stayed high since COVID ended and since inflation has come down, which has been about a year, go look at their corporate profits. If it's a publicly traded company, go look at their corporate profits. Because corporate greed is driving a lot of this price stickiness that we're seeing in many goods. That was also my answer to our friend Lisa's question about why does housing remain so damn expensive? Because developers and builders and construction companies are aiming for the highest profit margins. Because again, the cost of building stuff has come down post-COVID. Their biggest margins, single family homes, $400,000 or more. This is greedflation. Let's go to the phones, and then I'm going to tell you about the four reasons why I think people's perception, in addition to greedflation, remains that maybe our economy isn't doing so well, when in fact, again, according to the Wall Street Journal and Financial Times, we're the envy of the world. Karina from Milwaukee, you're on the air.
Hi. Oh, you know what? It's just about a topic I want to talk to you about. It because everybody says that the economy is good, but every time you go to the store, even the same items I'm buying, same store, I still every week pay more money. And I did look into it, and you're absolutely right. It's not something what people say that, well, Biden needs to do it. I mean, this is the corporate, but I still think that there is some degree where the government or a president, whoever he is, can help us with saying, guys, you know what? If you're not going to start adjusting prices, I'm going to increase your taxes. Because the only thing what those corporates are received and actually listened to off the government bench is that, oh, we want lower taxes. So we're giving them lower taxes, and they gain the prices, and the value is growing up, and the people who are selling are putting more and more margin in between. So, guys, you can work as a president your hands off. Nothing is going to happen because you have people on the market who actually don't care.
Yeah, I think you're onto something there. Listen, we could call this price gouging. We used to call this war profiteering. I'm going to call this pandemic profiteering. You heard that here on the Maggie Dawn Show. Pandemic profiteering, which effectively is price gouging. Now, listen, we live in a modified capitalist economy where the government can't cap prices. Now, that is in certain areas of goods and services. President Biden doing his damnedest to bring absolute essentials, for example, prescription drug prices, down through negotiated price agreements within Medicare, for example. But Karina's right. When we look at corporate tax rates, listen, I listen to conservatives all the time hammer on the American Rescue and Recovery Plan Act and the pandemic relief packages. That didn't touch the $8 trillion in increased U.S. debt that resulted from Donald Trump's 2017 tax cuts, which by far went to the richest corporations and the richest 1% of Americans. That's one of the problems. We need a tax code that works for the middle class. Now, if you think Donald Trump's going to get you that, I got some nice swampland to sell you. That is not part. You look at what he did in 2017. That ain't the plan here, folks. David from San Francisco, you're on the Maggie Don Show.
Oh, hi, Maggie. Yeah, two different angles on this. The United Way did a report about a year ago. I think it was March of 2023. And it showed how many vacant houses there are across America and compared to how many homeless people there are. Now, out here in San Francisco, we had 61,000 empty units that could be an apartment, condo, a house, and there were less than 10,000 homeless. So 6 or 7 times more empties than there are homeless people. In some cities, Detroit in this report had 118 empty units for every homeless person. I think Syracuse, New York had 110 empty units. So there are people who are hoarding houses and they're not releasing them and they're keeping the rent prices so high that it's really killing the middle class. The middle class can't afford to buy a house because they're hoarding these houses and not even selling them, you know, at a fair market value. And a fair market value would be far less than this, you know, $600,000 or $400,000. Out here in San Francisco, the average house is going, and this is a little house, is going for $1.4 million.
Yeah, that's incredible. So a couple things there. Average housing price in Waukesha County is now up over $400,000. To get into a 1,200 square foot house outside in Dane County, but outside of Madison proper, my colleague Todd Alba told me yesterday, that's costing upwards of $340,000, 1.3 or 4 for a single family home in San Francisco. Guess what else is happening? Not only are developers and construction companies building the things with the highest profit margins, not only do we have effectively artificially held back supply. When you hold the supply back of a needed good like housing, limiting supply drives price up. And part of the way that they're accomplishing that is that these huge hedge funds or private equity companies or investment companies are snapping up single family homes from coast to coast, especially in warm weather and highly desirable regions. Think the Southwest, think in the Research Triangle area, West Coast, Portland. Now, if you want to get into a starter home, you can't afford to buy it. You got to rent it from these massive companies that have been buying up this housing stock. We have a real problem here. Yes, lots of texters. Eric from Madison, exactly. Look where the money is going to the economy. It's not great from the average person's perspective because all the money is going right to the top 1%. Yep. And Trump's tax cut doesn't help that. Trickle down economics is a fantasy. It doesn't work like that. Another texter pointing out that, yeah, trickle down doesn't work because corporations, when they've got a lot of cash on hand, do what are called stock buybacks, which basically enrich the investment class, right? This is part of the problem. Now, what are some governmental sorts of responses? We can try to break up monopolies, right? And the U.S. Department of Justice is doing that more than ever. But that is sort of, you know, hey, that doesn't help the average gal or guy on the street who still needs, hey, I got to buy a house today. I can't wait for the, you know, antitrust lawsuit to go through. Another texter from the 608 saying, yeah, Maggie, businesses should not be able to own more than 4 or 5 homes as investment properties, just like this guy is talking about. Absolutely. And even in cities like Milwaukee, Green Bay, Racine, we're also seeing those huge companies that are doing this nationwide. We're also seeing that on smaller levels within densely populated urban areas where these massive landlords buy up properties, don't keep them up properly, and charge working families living paycheck to paycheck well over $1,200, $1,300 a month for apartments that you wouldn't wish on your worst enemy. Now, the city of Milwaukee and other city attorneys are trying to go after them, but we need to improve state laws to go after these derelict landlords that abuse working families in this state. I'd like to know what Robin Voss is doing about that, wouldn't you? Mark from Prairie du Sac, you are on the Maggie Dunn Show. What do you have to say this afternoon?
You had to bring up Voss because isn't he a slumlord as well? So I wouldn't expect him to do anything, you know, to help out, you know, the renter situation there. But the problem is that some of the policies we've been living under, you know, well, say here in Wisconsin, is failure to invest in our public infrastructure, going all the way back to, you know, to Scott Walker, you know, not increasing the broadband capacity that we had, even though the money was available. You know, high-speed rail or rail improvements that could have happened helped the economy. I mean, to build the economy up from the base is what they do not want to do. They think that we're just another tax cut for the people at the top, away from complete, economic, booms. And those booms certainly have not helped out the people at the bottom. When did the Sherman Antitrust Act pass? I mean, for some reason, it pops in my head, it was just before 1900. And we should be enforcing those laws. I mean, that to break these monopolies up, and because they saw the dangers even back then, over 100 years ago, they saw the dangers of this. Of the
Sherman Antitrust Act, 1890, it came after a bunch of basically fraud happening at the late turn of the century. Yeah, let's talk about Robin Voss as a landlord. Man, I'm going to just call him a slumlord. This is from a Journal Sentinel article published January 7th, 2020. Voss, Assembly Speaker Robin Voss is landlord of 23 properties in a college town, and reviews are decidedly mixed. Don't go anywhere. We'll keep going on this. 855-75-CIVIC. 855-752-4842. Where do you get your economic news? Why do you think public perceptions and economic reality are so mismatched? I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network. Wisconsin. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening statewide to the Civic Media Radio Network, talking about the economy this hour. 855-75-CIVIC, 855-752-4842. The economy is doing really well. Why don't people think so? What do you think? Somebody, Mark from Prairie du Sac called in, mentioned Robin Voss as a landlord. One of his tenants in Whitewater said this. This is Candace Berryman. He was a terrible landlord. I mean, terrible. So bad that Berryman and her four roommates moved out after they said they lost power more than two dozen times from June 2nd, 2010 to August 31st, 2010, court records show. When the women complained, they were told they had too many electronics plugged in, Berryman said. When we turned a blow dryer on in one bathroom, it took out all the TVs in the living room and some of our kitchen appliances. And then it took out the back unit's kitchen and their refrigerator and their microwave. That wasn't the only problem, she said. State inspection records show that the house also had mold. Several of my roommates, even after being there a month, had really bad allergic reactions, Berryman said. They couldn't breathe. Oh, and of course, once the five roommates moved out because a moldy place with no electricity, kind of uninhabitable. I don't know, maybe that's just me. Voss sued them, charging that they illegally broke their lease. Now, Berryman, who was the only one that paid the semester's rent in advance, she countersued, saying the property was uninhabitable. If you want to check out the rest of that, that's an article from the Journal Sentinel back in January of 2020. You know, Robin Voss, Assembly Speaker and slumlord. That's part of the problem. That is part of the problem. We're talking this hour about the economy. Really interesting think piece by Brian Buettler on his Substack. And he basically puts forth four observations about some of what's being manipulated about public perceptions. Now, they're the very real things that we all just talked about, right? That we see the prices in the grocery store that remain high. We look at housing prices high. Part of this is about greedflation, price gouging, pandemic profiteering. The other part of this is that it has been this way for a while, that our income disparities, that the rich are getting richer, the middle class less wealthy than it was 40 years ago. That's a result of a whole series of policies, but largely policies that were based on economic lies. There's never been an objective, independent economic study that's proved that trickle-down economics works. If you don't know what trickle-down is, it's like, well, give the rich people more stuff and everybody else will do just fine. But if rich people get richer, everybody else will do better too. How has that panned out, you know, since Nixon and Reagan? It hasn't. So here are the few things that Brian Buettler has pointed out. First of all, there's just a group on the right that even if we had an economy that was booming even more than it is, according to the Wall Street Journal and the Financial Times, they'd still say it was doing terribly because they simply can't fathom that the country would do well under a Democratic president. There's just that faction, right? Okay. Then there's the Republican cynics, the talking heads, who basically lie about it because they're feeding that unconvincible base. Think the Steve Bannons, the Fox News, particularly in primetime. Don't bother watching any of that nonsense. Elon Musk. Then you've got what I'm going to call like the online and what Brian Buettler refers to as the online wreckers. It's sort of the trolls and the people that figure out if they say really bad stuff and feed our fears, they get lots of clicks, they can sell more ads, they get richer, they get more famous. This is what Buettler called it. Clout-seeking doomsayers who know that spreading free-floating misery is a recipe for viral traffic. Yeah, I'll read that again. Clout-seeking doomsayers who know that spreading free-floating misery is a recipe for viral traffic. Yep. Now, there's an arm of that, which are the far, far leftists that'll never say anything positive because they want capitalism broken. They want socialism. There's a group of them. And just by the way, the central political question in liberalism, think Thomas Paine, Common Sense, 1776, is that government is to promote and protect the freedom of the individual. And the tension is that government can sometimes itself become an oppressive force. Now, that's sort of neoclassical liberalism. Modern liberalism says the government, to enhance freedom of the individual, needs to remove obstacles to reaching your individual potential, like poverty, disease, those sorts of things. But far leftists, that's not liberalism. That's socialism. There is that faction. There's the conspiracy theorists. They're sort of in this online miasma. Then you've got what I'm going to call lefty materialists that basically don't think the U.S. economy has ever been good or just, that it can never work. Now, I disagree with that premise. I think you look back to the New Deal. You look back to how the middle class was flourishing, had gained more wealth than ever before in U.S. history. Now, that didn't accrue equally amongst all demographics. It went mostly to white folks. But you look back at that period in the 50s and 60s, that's what you saw. The greatest expansion of wealth in the middle class ever seen in our country's history, largely based on New Deal policies. And yes, folks, those were wealth redistributive policies. Then you got the liberal quants who basically thought free trade would solve everything and everybody would get richer, and they can't quite figure out like why it isn't working. And then there's folks hawking stuff. They want you to buy things, that want to connect with you. But listen, at the end of the day, what you can do is arm yourself with information. I'm always here to help. I'll always do my best. But here are some sources for you. The Economist, Financial Times, Wall Street Journal, Ben Bernanke's blog, Paul Krugman's blog, NPR's Planet Money, Freakonomics Radio, the World Bank's blog. And of course, Robert Reich's blog, the Council on Foreign Relations, all of those will help you be a better consumer of economic information. I'm Maggie Dong. We have reached the top of the hour. We've got breaking news coming up. Don't go anywhere. News, weather, and sports, and then I'll be back here on the Civic Media Radio Network.